All right, if you would like to turn with me in your Bibles to Psalm 127, that's where I'd like to begin this morning. Psalm 127, and it's a relatively short portion of scripture, so we'll read it through, and then we'll open with a word of prayer. I'll let them finish distributing the handouts. I know I'm a person who likes to keep and take notes, so I wanted to print that off for anyone who would like that. Thank you very much for helping me with that. Psalm 127 in your Bibles this morning, and I'll read through it in entirety. Except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. Except the Lord keep the city, the watchman waketh but in vain. It is vain for you to rise up early, to sit up late, to eat the bread of sorrows, for so he giveth his beloved sleep. Lo, children are an heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his reward. As arrows are in the hand of a mighty man, so are children of the youth. Happy is the man that hath his quiver full of them. They shall not be ashamed, but they shall speak with their enemies in the gate. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for your word, and we pray that you would bless me as I bring forth your word, that it may edify, that it may build up the saints here, Lord, and just pray that each and every person can hear the message that you would have for them, and that this would be an encouragement and challenge for them as they go forth. We pray for Pastor and Justin as they are traveling and doing the missions week, and so we pray for them and pray you bless them. And for those who aren't here, Lord, I know there are some who are homesick. So we just pray for them and lift them up to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, with today being Father's Day and this week being VBS, I wanted to look at 7 steps to being a godly influence. Now, this isn't necessarily just being a godly father. This isn't necessarily just being a godly mother. This is being a godly influence because we all have people in our lives that we can influence for the cause of Christ. So I have 7 steps. On your sheet, it just says, be this, be this, be this. But what I want you to understand is this is... If I was a good drawer, if I you know, got out my tools, this would almost be like a pyramid. We're going to go line upon line, and things are going to build up as we go. So step one is a foundational truth. Step one is just simply be godly. While this may seem simple, it is absolutely foundational to being a good influence, a good father, a good mother, a good Christian. We cannot reap what we do not sow. We cannot harvest what we do not plant. So, as a parent, as a dad, my first priority and the way that I can best serve my family is to be a man of God, to be a man after God's own heart. The book of Mark in chapter 12, verse 28 through 30 says, "And one of the scribes came, and having heard them reason together, perceived that he had answered them well, he asked him," meaning Jesus. So this person comes to Jesus and says, "Which is the first commandment of all?" Many of you know the Old Testament. Many of you know this portion of Scripture. Jesus answered him, "The first of all commandments is, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first commandment." I wanted to start here today because I love the directness of this scripture. They come to Jesus and say, "God, you gave us 10 commandments. If you're a really rabbi, what's the greatest commandment?" And he doesn't say, "You know what, love God on Sundays." That's important. He doesn't say, "Come to church if you have a free weekend." He doesn't say, "Make sure your kids and your grandkids come to VBS and then you'll be fine." God's command, his order, his directive, his requirement is that we love God with all our heart, all of our soul, all of our mind, and all of our strength. Now, clearly, this is not just a commandment for dads on Father's Day. This clearly is not just a commandment for parents. This is a commandment for every believer in Jesus Christ. Young people, this is for you just the same as it is for me. Now, one thing I do have to say, what I see, and I've visited churches in different states and different things like that. My challenge to the men, to the fathers on Father's Day, is I have yet to find a church filled with godly fathers, godly men who labor in the Word, labor in Scripture, that appears to be lifeless and dying. Okay? The heart of the home and the heart of the church is good, godly people and godly men who help lead the church. Now, I have seen a lot of Christian families where the mom is the strongest Christian, or she is the one who is pursuing Christ, and she's advocating for her family to go to church on Sunday. And women, if you are here today, let me tell you, you are not alone. That is laboring in God's Word. That is helping to guide and direct. That is fighting the good fight. Your labor is not in vain. We are all called by God to be spiritual, to be godly. And if that's you today, whether you're man or woman, you are called to be godly and to lead your home. Those who love the Lord are asked to love God. Those who have been born again of the Spirit are called to love God with all their heart, with all their soul, with all their mind, and with all their strength. So that is the foundational truth of how we can serve others, how we can love others, and be that godly influence. Step two is be a servant. In Mark 12, verse 31, Jesus continues and says, "The second like it is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no greater commandment than these." Now, I'll be honest, this is something that some men struggle with. Some men struggle to be servants because society wants to tell us that success for a man means you're the one that's holding the trophy at the end of the event, that you're the one that gets the glory, that you're the one who is built up. But that's not the pattern we see in Scripture. That's not what the Bible tells us. Society tries to tell men and all of us that, you know what, success means things like large bank accounts, an important job title, that, you know, success means having a powerful pickup, a shiny sports car, or a fast speedboat or a big fishing boat. The world tries to sell us that success is what you do instead of who you are. But that's not what the Bible says at all. Let's look at what Jesus tells his disciples when they start asking themselves, who's going to be the greatest? Look in your Bibles over to the book of Mark chapter 9. We're going to be in the book of Mark a fair amount this morning, so you can probably stay here. We'll flip around a couple chapters. But Mark chapter 9, and we're going to read verses 33 through 35. It says, "Then he," meaning Jesus, "came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, 'What was it that you disputed among yourselves on the road?'" He's talking to the disciples here. "But they kept silent, for on the road they had disputed among themselves who would be the greatest. And he sat down, called the 12, and he said to them, 'If anyone desires to be first, he shall be last of all and servant of all.'" Servant leadership is not easy, because really it doesn't come natural for any of us. Now, some of us are blessed with that in our spiritual gift to be a servant, but servant leadership doesn't come naturally because we all want what our flesh wants. Jesus is the ultimate example of a selfless person. You think about it, Jesus is our ultimate example of what we should all aspire to be. And when society tells us, you know what, you're supposed to pursue greatness, you're supposed to pursue trophies and be built up, I look at Jesus and I see zero Super Bowl titles. He never owned a sports car. He never dated a supermodel. And he died a lonely, humiliating death. Not exactly what the world says that we should follow and aspire to be at all. But that's exactly what God says. He says, if we want to be first, we have to put ourselves last. If you want to be great for God, you have to have a heart to serve others. For the first two steps here are foundational. Everything else that I'm going to build upon starts on these two concepts: to love God with your heart, your soul, your mind, your strength, and then to serve others with your life. Step three this morning is to be in God's Word. I'm going to put step three and step four kind of side by side if we're building up levels. Step three is be in God's Word. I don't know how anyone can say that they truly love God without wanting to spend time in their Bible. That's not saying that people can't be good people, that people can't love and serve God without doing it. But if you truly love God, you will want to, you will desire to read His Word and spend time with Him. We don't naturally want to follow God on our own. The book of Isaiah in chapter 53, verse 6 says, "All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way." And Jeremiah 17, verse 9 tells us, "The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked." So we don't have the desire innate in us to follow God. If we know ourselves and we truly understand and believe these things from Scripture, then we understand that we need to continuously fill our hearts with Scripture. We need to continually be in the Word of God to fill ourselves with Him rather than the things that we want of ourselves. And how can we expect to teach others about Jesus? How can we expect others to get a passion for God if we ourselves aren't in the Bible? If we just want to set it on our nightstand and let it collect dust throughout the week? I'm here to say that as a parent, the best way that you can help your kids want to read the Bible is to sit there and read it with them. Side by side with them, help them to read it. Help them to learn it. Help them to see you loving it. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 6 through 9 says, "And these words which I command you today shall be in your heart." So this is God's declaration to the nation of Israel. In fact, this, I believe, was part of the Shema that they would read out to the nation and ring out and then basically proclaim it out almost on a daily basis. It says, "You shall teach them diligently to your children. You shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates." I read that, and God isn't telling me, you know what, you should probably get up on Sunday and go to church. And that's enough. God isn't saying, you know what, if you go Wednesday nights, that's really what I want. God doesn't want part of my life. He wants to be what I live for. He wants me to live for Him. He wants me to love and get up every day with a spirit of how can I live for God. I'm here to tell you I fail that. I'm here to tell you that I fail Him every day. That doesn't mean that that's not what God desires of me. It is, and I know that. But I fail Him every day. God says that we should have His Word all over our house. It should be what we speak about, what we talk about with friends, what, you know, it's plastered on the walls of our house, on our gates of our entering in of our gates and things like that. God's saying it should be a part of your everyday life. It should permeate every part of your life. Now, the only way that God can be on our mind and He can be the thing that we talk about in the morning, the thing that we talk about at the noon, the thing that we talk about at night, the only way that that happens is if we're reading His Word every day and letting it change us. So being in His Word is an important step. And the other side of that layer that I would add in step four is to be in prayer. This is another obvious one, but I honestly feel like this is something that a lot of people overlook. You know, men, I don't know about you, but there's some things I'm not very good at. All right, I see my wife's here. Let me rephrase that. There's a lot of things that I'm not good at. One of the things that I know that men struggle with is asking for directions. So there was a study by ABC News that said that 74% of women say that they're fine asking for directions. So 3 out of 4 women have no problem stopping and asking for directions. They ask men the same thing. 30% of men say that they're okay asking for directions. So 3 in 4 women, about less than 1 in 3 men are okay asking for directions. So whether it's that we're lost on the road, reading directions from something we need to build, men just don't do this well. I also understand that some men are not great communicators. So it seems logical that if we're not great communicators and we're not good at asking for direction, that sometimes men have a hard time praying like we ought to. Again, I'm looking at myself here and saying, do I do a good job of going to the Lord in prayer? Do I do a good job of going to God and asking for His guidance? Prayer brings us to the throne of God. It humbles us. It reminds us that we are not in control of our lives. Prayer is how we go to God. We talk to Him. We pour out our hearts to Him. Prayer is how we show reliance on an almighty, all-powerful, all-knowing God. And we ask Him for guidance. We ask Him for direction. 1 Thessalonians 5:17 is a short and simple command. God says, pray without ceasing. Now, that doesn't mean that we're all supposed to go join a monastery and for 18 hours a day do nothing but give our time to praying to God and not do anything with the rest of the world. What that means is that I'm supposed to talk to God throughout the day. I'm supposed to start my day in prayer to God and talk to Him. That as I have breakfast, I'm going to sit there and talk to God about my day and go to Him in prayer. As I go to work and I'm sitting there, I should be praying on my way to work for the people that I'm going to be working with. As I go throughout my day, I should be talking to God, asking for His guidance. Being in continual prayer is about having an open dialogue with God, recognizing that He is there. He's there when I wake up in the morning. He's there when I'm having breakfast. He's there when I'm driving to work. He's there in my workplace. Recognizing that helps put a lot of things in perspective. So pray without ceasing is about us being in continual and constant communication to God. Go to Him with the big things. Go to Him with the little things. Go to Him with the hurt feelings. Your Heavenly Father cares for you. He wants to hear from you. He wants to help you and guide you. And we all need to make sure that we are making time to go to God throughout the day in prayer. So, we have to love God with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, all our strength. We have that we should be a servant. We should have that we should be in God's Word and that we should be in prayer. The first 4 steps that I mentioned focus on our relationship with God. If we are going to be a godly influence on people around us, the next 3 steps, steps 5, 6, and 7, are going to talk about how we have a relationship with other people. Okay? So step 5, if you're taking notes today, is be present. Or if you prefer, be there. I read a devotional the other day, and I wanted to share this with you. This is the author's words, so I'm just going to go ahead and read it. Have you ever been left? Like, really left? I have. When I was in 2nd grade, my dad took my family to the county fair. I was so excited just to be walking the aisles of vendors and smelling the fair food. I didn't get to do many special things as a child, so this was a rare treat for my family. My dad dropped me and our 4 siblings and my mom off and ran to get some cash from the ATM. I'll be right back, he said. I'll meet you inside the gate. But he never came back. I waited. Hour after hour passed, and I never saw that brown Honda that should have been carrying my dad reappear at the gate. Unfortunately, for our country, the loving two-parent household is becoming increasingly rare. Many moms are left to shoulder the burden of raising children as a single parent. Other women might be married but have a husband who's gone all the time or simply not even present when he's there. Being there with the people that you love is important. Being there for your wife and kids is about more than just being a figure in their lives. Men, we are called to provide for our family. That is what the scripture said. But I'm here to tell you that if you are here today on Father's Day as a dad, you are more than a paycheck. Your responsibility to your family is about more than just paying the bills. Being present, this command that says be present, means taking an interest in people's lives. Taking an interest in your family. It means being the person, if you're a dad, who asks your kids how their day at school was. It means knowing your child's favorite song or their best friend. It means knowing what they want to be when they grow up. At my office, I have a sign that I believe my wife and kids got me for Father's Day, I think maybe even last year, and it says, anybody can be a father, but it takes someone special to be a dad. You know, this truth of being there doesn't just apply to dads. It applies to all of us. A dad is someone who spends time with their kids doing their favorite activity. Maybe it's coaching their son's t-ball team or having tea parties with their daughters. It's about being there, being present with people. As I think about my day, I usually see my boys usually wake up about 7:10, 7:15, and by 7:45 to 7:50, I'm off to work. I'll get home from work, maybe get home about 6 o'clock, we'll have supper, and by 8:30 they're in bed. So on any given day, that puts me about 3 hours of time that I have with my kids. Now, I looked this stat up and it says, in the U.S., the average person spends 3 hours and 39 minutes a day on their phones. That means that the average American would spend more time on their phones than the time I get to see my kids in their waking hours each and every day during the work week. Parents, if we are not careful, we will lose the most important years of our kids' lives. And I know this is an epidemic among men, parents in general, but men especially. Any man can sit in the same room with his children and scroll through his phone. Anybody can do that. You don't have to be a dad to do that. But a dad, a godly man, will put his phone down and give his kids attention. Step five, and again, this isn't just for dads, this is for all of us, be present with people. Be truly there for them. I'm going to switch this and I'm going to talk a little bit. When you're a dad, you have to I'm going to switch this and say to coworkers. When you're at work, you're going to talk to your coworkers. When you're around your neighbors, you're going to share stories. Do you actively listen to them? Are you wanting to truly get to know them, to know their struggles, to know what you can be praying for them, to know how you can show them the love of Christ? It talks about that I've seen studies that say that we can process words about 2.5 times faster than we can talk. So there's this ability that we have to listen to somebody, maybe you're doing it with me right now, and we kind of drift off. We think about other things. We think about what we want to say next instead of being there in the moment listening to them. Are you trying to reach your neighbor or coworker with the gospel? There's a saying that I love that says, people want to know you care before they'll ever care what you know. Being present with people means to get to know them and to invest in them, to see their lives and them as precious souls for God. Couples, when you sit down at night with your spouse and they start to tell you about your day, do you kind of nod and drift off? Or do you try to truly understand what's on their heart? How they feel, how things affect them. James 1:9 says, "Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath." I actually had that in a devotional a few weeks ago, wrote it on a post-it note, put it on our fridge, because that's something that I want to work on. Be swift to hear and slow to speak. God gives us two ears and one mouth for a reason. Did you know you can hear and process things faster? Because we need to stop what we're doing and actually take time to listen. So be present with people. Step 6, be loving or be merciful. Now, again, this may seem obvious that if we're trying to reach someone, we have to be kind, we have to be loving, we have to be merciful with them. I know that your church just finished a week of vacation Bible school. I don't know about you, but I love the week of VBS. Our kids look forward to VBS every year, and I honestly think that some weeks or some years, I look forward to it more than they do. Because I love seeing the energy that kids have. I love being able to be a small part of what God's doing to give His truth to these young people and make it important in their lives, and to see that come alive for them throughout the week of VBS. It can be a long, exhausting week serving at VBS. But man, the rewards are heavenly. It is so rewarding. There's a picture that I love from a few years ago at VBS here at Good News that always sticks with me. And I'm going to try and paint the picture. I don't have it here with you. But I'm going to tell you the reason that it's kind of convicting to me. It's a memory that's etched in my mind. There was a little girl in my wife's class who I think was here for the VBS for the very first time. Okay? She didn't know a lot of kids in her class. She had a big class. And so she was quiet. She was a little unsure. And they went out for game time. All the other kids run excitedly out to the middle. They're ready to run and jump and get out all sorts of energy, which is a great part of VBS, right? This little girl is quiet and shy, and she's sitting on the sideline, scared to participate. So my wife sees that, and she goes over and she squats down to the little girl. She gets on her level, and she quietly and patiently talks to her about what the game is and encourages her to participate. My wife saw that little girl and left the class and went to try to meet her needs where she was. The reason that image challenges me is because it reminds me of what Jesus does with each and every one of us. He knows you. He sees your needs. And He is willing to leave the 99 and to go after the one that has gone astray. Now, you might not be here today and say, I haven't gone astray. I understand. But what I'm saying is, God's willing to do that. God's willing to make time for you. God knows you. He knows your needs. He knows what you're going through. And He's willing to come here. He came down from heaven. He left the glories of heaven to come and become a man, to be at our level, to speak to us at our level, to look humans eye to eye and to share with them the purpose, the truths about the kingdom of heaven. That's the heart that we need to have to try to reach the world. Okay? We can't be the people that are sitting there directing traffic and barking orders and telling people, this is what you do, this is what you do. We have to be the people that take time to go one-on-one with people, sit down with them, love them, and share God's truth with them. For parents, we have to love our kids. Whether they're big or small, whether they're a toddler or a teen, they all have needs that only you can meet. Your coworkers only have needs that you can meet. God puts you there in their lives for a reason and a purpose. People need to know that we care about them. Our kids need to know that we love them unconditionally. Sometimes young people, again, speaking from experience, sometimes young people act out. Sometimes one of our sons will act out and he'll be angry or scared or frustrated. And it's really easy for me to see the behavior and not the kid. It's really easy for me to get frustrated at what he's doing and not understand the why. And I pray that in those moments, God gives me the patience, the wisdom, and the grace to see their real needs. Yes, there's times that kids need discipline and they need consequences. And there's also times where they need love, they need reassurance, and they need someone that will listen. Ephesians 6:4 puts this beautifully when it says, "And fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up in the training and admonition of the Lord." In the King James Version, the word is actually the nurture and admonition of the Lord. For the dads here today, yes, your kids need to respect your authority. And they should listen and obey. But isn't it better if they do so out of love and respect rather than out of fear and duty? Another way to think of the verse is in Proverbs 15, verse 1, it says, "A soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger." I'm ashamed to tell you that there's lots of times that I respond out of anger, that I raise my voice and I get angry rather than getting down at my kids' level. The Bible tells us God loves people. God loves children. God loves your coworker who doesn't know God. And when they're sitting there saying stupid stuff, they're sitting there making comments that frustrates you and just makes your blood want to boil, God says, "You know what? I died for that soul." Have love on them. Have patience with them. Have compassion for them. I wonder how well I'm doing at noticing and meeting the needs of others. Am I making time, sacrificing for other people the way I should be? That little girl standing off the sides of VBS, am I the person standing there telling people, "This is all what you need to do, getting ready to play games," and not convicting here the game leaders? Or am I the person that goes over to them, kneels down, and talks to them, and connects to their heart? We need to be present with people. Step 7, be intentional. Who are you trying to actively reach with the gospel of Christ? I want you to take a moment and think about that. Who am I actively trying to win for Jesus Christ, to add to his kingdom? Who are you planning to have over to your home and have over for dinner so you can get to know them and maybe have a chance to share the gospel with them? Zig Ziglar is quoted as saying, "If you aim at nothing, you'll hit it every time." Life has a way of keeping us busy. There are bills to pay, chores to do, errands to run. We are all busy with one thing or another, but you are always going to be sacrificing for something. God says, "Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." Meaning you can tell what a person cares about by what they're willing to spend their time and their money investing in. Look back with me to Psalm 127. We started there today. Psalm 127. I'm going to read verse 1, and then I'm going to skip to verses 3 through 4. It starts off, "Unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who build it. Unless the Lord guards the city, the watchman stays awake in vain. Behold, children are a heritage from the Lord. The fruit of the womb is a reward. Like arrows in the hand of a warrior, so are children in one's youth. Happy is the man who has a quiver full of them. They shall not be ashamed, but they shall speak with their enemies in the gate." I want to touch on this verse of scripture because I love the imagery that children are like arrows in the hand of a warrior. Most men would love to be considered a warrior, whether that's a mighty warrior, a spiritual warrior. We like to be people that are willing to go to battle for the things we believe in. And if you can view children as an arrow in the hand of a skilled archer, the idea is that we are to have the responsibility to set their trajectory and to point them in the right direction, and then launch them out into life to the goal that they will love and serve the Lord Jesus Christ. And that thought, parents, are you being intentional about the things that you let influence your children? Grandparents, are you being intentional about how you help with your grandchildren? From the friends you encourage them to make, the books they read, the shows they watch, are we pointing the next generation to Jesus Christ? Every generation grows up with lots of influences. TV, the media, songs. There's lots of these outside influences of the world that want to pull them away from the God of the Bible. We have to influence them with the God of the Bible. We have to influence the next generation with the truths of Scripture by coming to church, by helping them read their Bibles, by bringing them to Sunday school and VBS. Each of us gets the same number of hours every week. Every one of us gets 168 hours to spend. And what you spend your time on is up to you. But how does your time, your money, your resources, how do the things that you spend those things on reflect the truth of what you know about God? If God is a priority in your life, you won't have to come and tell me after the service. Okay? You'll never be able to convince someone you're living for God when they know that you're not. And if you're living for God, you won't have to tell people that's what you're doing. It should be evident in the fact that God is a part of every part of our life. People ought to see your example and know that you've surrendered your life to Jesus Christ. Now, wasting an hour watching a show or scrolling through a phone can be somewhat harmless. And I'm not sitting here saying that every hour of our day needs to be done for this or that. But when 20 minutes turns into 2 hours, and days and weeks and years are added up, suddenly we might look back and miss the time that we could have been spending investing in people. The time that we regret not picking up the phone and calling our friend, calling our mom or dad to check in on them. The time that we didn't spend at work talking to somebody, getting to know them, and sharing the gospel with them. So those are the 7 steps. They build on one another. To be godly means to love the Lord your God with your heart, your soul, your mind, your strength. To be a servant means to put others above yourself. To be in God's word and be in prayer, that should be our daily commitment for God. And then as we look at other people, let's be present, meaning to truly be there for them. Let's be loving and merciful with people and how we interact with them. And let's be intentional about reaching people and sharing God's truth with them. If you can take a look today and look over this list with an earnest desire, I think we can all find areas that we need to do better for God, that we can do better at loving people. For dads here today, please make sure you make time for your family. In life, the days are long, but the years are short. None of us know how much time we have with people. You know what? The season of something on Netflix won't matter in the grand scheme of things. You know what? The time that you spend at work and not with your family, something you might live to regret. I promise you, you will never regret investing in the people that matter most in your life, in the relationships that matter most in your life, because that's what God has called us to do. Let's go ahead and pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your truths and the challenges from Scripture that you want us to go out and reach people, whether that's our friends, our coworkers, our neighbors, the next generation, the young people in our families, in our homes, in our church. Lord, you've called us to go out and to be intentional in how we can influence people for the cause of Christ. And I pray, God, that you would help us to look at how you would have us to interact, how do you have us to share your word and your love with people. I thank you for everyone here today. I thank you for the blessing of your word and being able to bring it forth. And I just pray that you would work in every heart for the message that you would have for them to take with them today. I ask these things in our Lord Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Thank you.